I'm going to keep saying it until... Thank you, Jacob. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rebecca Nessel, and I'm the Director of Cultural Programs for Grace Cathedral. And we're so excited to have you with us today, and also for those folks who are watching online as we live stream. I just have a couple of announcements before we start this beautiful concert. I'm really excited about what's about to happen. We ask you to silence your cell phones. And I just wanted to let you know that if you enjoy programs like this one, we really encourage you to become a cultural member of Grace Cathedral and join our Grace Arts program. One of the benefits is that you don't need to register for the organ recital. You can just show your card. And there's information about that in the front where you came in. I also wanted to let you know that we rely on your support to keep organ recitals free for everyone. If you are able, please give us a cash donation in the box just in front of the altar there or at the main entrance. You can also text GRACE, G-R-A-C-E, to 76278. Thank you. And now it gives me very great pleasure to introduce Angela Kraft Cross.
Thank you so very much. It's just always such a beautiful experience to be here in Grace Cathedral. I think it's hard not to be in this building and, you know, not have a spiritual experience here. It's just such a glorious spiritual space. So today's program is going to sort of alternate between pieces that I have written and then favorites of mine from the French Romantic tradition. So the piece you just heard, the Variations on Ode to Joy, for those of you who have studied music, you have classical variations like what Mozart and Haydn would write, or even Beethoven. Then you have like romantic variations that are based on like little motifs and things. And then I decided that maybe I wanted to do something different. So I asked myself the question, if Picasso were to write a set of variations, what would it sound like? So it's sort of, it's inspired by analytical cubism. So that's why it sounded like it interrupted itself all the way through. The next piece I'd like to play for you is my Sanctus from Petite Messe d'Orgue. And that means little organ mass. And I have spent a significant amount of time in France. And I think part of my spiritual being is French Catholic, just having been in that situation so many times. And the Sanctus, usually done around the time of communion, Hosanna in the highest, and holy, holy, holy. The next two works I'm going to play for you come from the 20th century in France. And I'm going to be playing for you first a work by Maurice Durafle, who is considered to be, as much as he's a 20th century composer, he is considered to be one of basically the last French impressionists. You think of Debussy and you think of Ravel. Durafle sort of took a lot of that, and that is part of an important part of his writing. He also did a lot of things with chant. And this particular piece, the Scherzo Opus 2, as you can tell by the very low number, happened during his student years. So it's one of his very first compositions, and you can see the gift of this wonderful composer and what, you know, ended up being a number of very beautiful works. And then I'm going to play for you a favorite of Louis Vierne, who is, you know, a few decades older than Durafle. In fact, Durafle was standing at his side when he died on the bench, playing a concert at Notre Dame, where he was the organist. Louis Vierne was a blind organist, and he, like Vidor, wrote a number of symphonies, but he also had a little bit of an impressionistic twist too, because he's a colleague of like Debussy and Ravel. And his fantasy pieces, I think, are more of his impressionistic output. Now, the irony to all that is that the impressionists were very much into visual, and of course, Louis Vierne was blind, but he did a really good job of pulling off impressionism, even though he was blind. And I'm going to play for you one of the favorites out of the fantasy pieces, which is Carillon de Westminster, which has the bells of Big Ben in London that go all the way through. Healing Waters from, I think, 2022, which was dedicated to Robert's mom. She passed, unfortunately. And it is a piece about the Monterey Coast and how those beautiful, big, savage waves down there for Martin Luther King Sunday. And I decided that it was time for me to actually finally put something down on paper. And what you will hear is you will hear a lot of development on We Shall Overcome. And then the middle section is basically the mother hymn to the Martin Luther King's favorite hymn, which was Precious Lord. But the mother hymn to that was taken from is called Maitland. Thank you so much. I forgot to tell you one story ahead of that one. When I was first talking to Chris Keady about playing this as part of my program, he informed me that Martin Luther King actually had a history with this church. And he actually preached here on, I think it was March 28, 1965. And I believe it was at the consecration of sort of the rebuilding of Grace Cathedral after the 1906 quake sort of took it out. And yes, it took 60 years to get there, but to me that's very exciting that Martin Luther King was right here in our midst. And so this is in his honor. I'm going to close out today with two movements of one of my favorite Vidor symphonies. Charles-Marie Vidor is a French romantic. He was the organist at Saint-Sulpice in Paris, and if you ever get a chance to go up in the organ loft in Saint-Sulpice, it is well worth the trip. He had a really amazing tenure. He lived to 94, and I think he was the organist titulaire at Saint-Sulpice for 64 years, which has got to be pretty close to the Guinness Book of World Records on that. But we organists know him as someone who wrote 10 organ symphonies. And back in that day, going into the 1800s, the organ lofts of Paris had pretty much all been decimated by the French Revolution. There was a little too much connection with the church and the organ and royalty, and there was a lot of ammunition that was made out of organ pipes. And so there was a genius organ builder named Aristide Cavaillé-Cole. And Aristide Cavaillé-Cole had a new concept of what he wanted to do with organ building. And he wanted organs to sound more like a symphony orchestra. And he was so good at what he did, sort of like the same way Stradivarius was good at making violins, that he inspired several generations of composers to write organ symphonies. And by that, we mean solo organ, but sort of emulating the power and sonorities that you can get, you know, with a symphony. So the most famous symphonies, of course, are the fifth and the sixth. And I sort of, in Sandra Soderlund's terminology, she calls them party symphonies, and I would agree. They're like extremely accessible and a lot of fun. The seventh symphony, he really starts to branch out and study what his fellow orchestral writers are writing in the German Romantic era, and he's doing even more of that with the eighth. And it's interesting to me that all 10 of his symphonies were written in the 1800s before Vierne wrote his first. So that's sort of interesting continuity there. So I am going to play you two movements from the eighth. The first one is sort of the scherzo movement. And this piece has so much personality. I sort of picture Inspector Clouseau sneaking around. It's just a very, very cute piece. And then there's, of course, the grand finale at the end. Stormy that, you know, resolves. Thank you.